How do we produce sounds? What's the mechanism involved in that? And then, what's the role of airflow, extra air, voicing, that is vibration in the vocal cord and things like that, right? That was the idea. That was the idea of that discussion on sound. So now we will begin with words. Go ahead.
So when languages differ in the number of consonants which they have, or the different sounds they have, what might be the reason that some languages have adopted more sounds as part of their languages while others have not? Is there a history? Can it be justified by some reason? Why do languages differ in the number of sounds?
Why do languages differ in number of sounds? Why do some languages have more sounds, some have less sounds, some have certain specific sounds and others don't have? You were saying something?
I did not understand. Every language has the same number of sounds.
No, not true. Approximately same. For example, you will not find a language with 20 and the other with 50. See that? So, they will have approximately similar numbers, like 42, 46 or 48. No language will have 20 or 25 and then others will have 50 or 70. Okay? They do not have same number. At the same time, the differences are not too wide.
Some languages in Africa which have more than 100 sounds. I can't remember the name of the language, but they have unique sounds, like they also have that part of their language.
Right.
So
they are called clicks.
Clicks.
Right.
Yeah, the exclamation point.
Right.
So what might be the reason that?
See, first of all, there aren't 100. Okay. Second, some of those things are supra-segmental features, okay? For example, in our languages, we too have something called nasalization. It's part of many, many languages. But to give you one example from our languages, we have nasalization, which is different from nasals, okay? For example, we have a sound called ma, right? Like mama, ma. But then we have something else which is called nasalization. Now, what's nasalization? It's something like, let's say when we say a word, ankh. Ankh. Ankh is the word for
eye.
It's a Hindi word for eye. Now, the first sound of this word is a. It's not ark. What is it? Ark. The first vowel is nasalized. Right. That moon and the dot thing is the marker in writing system for nasalization. Now, you may have noticed, I don't have it on my schedule to talk about written system, but you may have noticed in some words you just see a dot. And in some you see moon and the dot. There is a difference between the two. I hope we get some time to talk about that. However, we need to get to principles in more details. Nonetheless, they represent two different things. Moon and the dot is representing nasalization, which is a feature on a particular sound. The dot is simply representing another sound, which is nasal. Okay? Now, how they do those things, I'll show you some other time, and if I find some space for that. Important thing with reference to your question is, nasalization is something which is called supra-segmental feature. Now, it comes on a sound. It is not a sound by itself. Therefore, several of such things may not be. I'm not denying, because I don't know which language you are talking about. I don't know the sound inventory of that language to deny anything outright. But some of them are suprasegmental features. Okay, that's number one. Number two, and those are the things which are responsible for when someone says accents, right? Accent most of the time is used as a derogatory word to mark the language low. It said, your language has an accent, right? However, the technical term accent also means differences caused by suprasegmental features, okay? So, that's also another aspect of that. There is one more thing which we need to discuss before we move to words, because now we are moving from sounds to words. When we look at words, we know that they are not just a random collection of sounds, right? That's well established. We may not know each and every rule, each and every pattern which is responsible for the strings of sounds that we get in a particular word, or what are the strings that are allowed and what are the strings that are not allowed. We may not know all of them, however, we know that they are not random collection of sounds. They have an underlying pattern in it. We are going to see some patterns today, which is going to answer the question, how do we make words? But there is another element which is larger than sounds and smaller than word, okay? And this thing is called a syllable. Have you heard this word, syllable? What does it mean to you when you hear the word syllable?
It represents a certain sound, actually.
With reference to sounds. Actually, what it is the following. It's more than sound. It's larger than sounds and smaller than a word. For example, a word may have 2 to 3 syllables or maybe 4 syllables, okay? However, one sound may also constitute one syllable, okay? But the question of syllable comes in only when we are talking about words. If we cut the words in different parts, then we get several syllables. This is called a process called syllabification. And we know that a word may be divided into 2 syllables, then they are called bisyllabic or disyllabic word, or a monosyllabic word. If we cannot divide them into 2 or 3, then they are called monosyllabic words. Okay, so please keep this thing in mind. There is something called syllable, which is larger than sounds but smaller than words. Syllables do not extend beyond the word boundaries. They stay within words. Okay? So now let's very quickly look at these things. My idea is to get to sentences by tomorrow. So we have been looking at these things off and on, right? Where these things simply mean consonants and vowels. Now, the first pattern that you see, CV, right, which tells you several things. Probably we have referred to these things while discussing other aspects, but for once again, let me say this thing. The first pattern simply tells you, first and second, that the most common pattern for the formation of word is CV. Nobody knows how many words can we make with this pattern. That simply means a lot of words. There is no restriction on how many of them can be made. Also, it means we must have a vowel in a word. when we say most common pattern, we mean if we have a proper alternation or at a regular interval, consonant, vowel, then we probably get more, right? Which also means that we can have a vowel, consonant alterations, which will mean the same thing. We can also have simply words with 2 to 3 vowels, okay? And again, the underlying thing is no word with only consonants in any language. These are the underlying things. The third thing, when you see, what does this tell you? When you see, there are 2 consonants in the beginning, right? That's a cluster. Okay, it means when 2 of them are together, they not necessarily, but they will form a cluster. Does anybody understand what a cluster means?
Yes.
Cluster is not just the juxtaposition of 2 sounds. What does it mean? Somebody?
A little part of the first sound and the starting part of the second sound might be cut off.
Exactly.
Might overlap.
No overlap. A part of the previous consonant disappears. It's important to know which part of that previous consonant. We are talking about a sound, and again we are talking about a part of that sound has to disappear in order to make a cluster. Do you see how what a microscopic look it becomes when we look at words, right? So which part of that sound do we cut or gets disappeared? The vowel part, right? We know that every consonant comes with a vowel which is called an inbuilt vowel, which is just one particular vowel. This vowel is a short a. It's shorter than a, or definitely way shorter than a. A is a completely different sound. We don't find that anywhere in any consonant. When you see a in a consonant, that's an additional sound, right? In a word like ma or ka, ka and a are 2 different sounds, right? So the sound like ka comes with an inbuilt vowel a, which is a small vowel. It's called a schwa, but let's call it a vowel. In order to make it a cluster, that goes away. That vowel disappears, and then we get the following consonant forming cluster with that one. Okay? And we have seen examples like school, station, scooter, right, and many more. This cluster is possible in the beginning of a word, in the middle of a word, also at the word boundary, okay? However, there are a couple of things that work as constraint and that are important for us to keep in mind. Only the first sound is responsible for forming the cluster. That is, in a cluster, the first sound, that is first consonant, will lose its inbuilt vowel. The second one will not. If the second one loses its vowel, then it's going to form cluster with the following one. See that? And this can happen at any position in a word, beginning, middle, and end, with the break of a vowel. Okay? If there is no break, then they're going to form cluster with 3 consonants. If we say there are some words which have cluster of 3 consonants in the beginning of a word, okay? You get this question? If we say there are some words which have 3 consonants forming a cluster in the beginning of a word, what do we mean? What are the two consonants that are losing their vowels? First and second, right? Third one is not going to lose its vowel, all right? Now, before we see the see some more examples of the first, second, third, fourth one, let's look at the third one again. The difference between first and second put together and the third is striking, which is, remember what I told you about the first one, total number of words that we can make with this possible pattern is a lot, that is infinite. We don't know how many, therefore we don't even count. However, the presence of a cluster in a word reduces the number of words way too low. That is, the number of total words in any language with clusters is very few. This very few may not be handful that you can count, but when we say very few, we mean compared to the first one, way too low. Okay? What's the meaning of this thing? If you look at it in, if you can elaborate this thing in a little bit more, what does it mean? Which one is more common? Which one is easier? We get unlimited number of words with a pattern, right? Definitely that pattern has to be an easier pattern. Only then we are getting so many of them. Now, we are getting very few, that is way too fewer, with clusters, which simply means that's a heavy word. And for the vocal apparatus, for the word formation process and generative mechanism, that's a expensive word. That's a tough one. Therefore, we have very few of them. This I am very well aware, we didn't completely answer your question that why differences in number of words, but this will tell you something. But one more thing I want to add to your question, not necessarily as an answer, is this question is like, why do we have so many languages, right, which we don't have a clear answer of. Okay, it's just that we have so many of them. Similarly, it's an empirical fact that languages differ in terms of number of words. And get this thing?
Sir, can we say that because, say, long time ago, because there was geographical isolation between mm-hmm. different groups or civilizations, I mean, there were no civilizations if you go long back, but different groups, because there was geographical isolation, so one group, they developed their own languages, each group developed their own languages, and since they did not communicate earlier, so they were not exposed to new sounds or different sounds which can be produced. Some groups explored their vocal apparatus more compared to other groups.
Right.
Can we say that?
Probably yes, but this, you can say the same thing in a different way also, which is, or similar things in a different way. See, we have talked about language continuum even today, right? We have seen the continuum of Assamese, Bangla, Odia and Telugu. Definitely Telugu has some sounds which Bangla doesn't have, and Bangla has some sounds which Assamese doesn't have, or Odia may not have, right? Still they form a continuum. It's possible for us to see that continuum today because we are aware of the geography. Now, as you said, long, long time ago, and that's possible, it's just a speculation, long, long time ago, when people started moving, right, that movement was probably permanent. right? We are also familiar with what we know as Big Bang theory, right? That was way too big, and I don't want to go that far. We don't know, we don't have evidence of that time, if we had language or not, or if it was there in what shape and all, we don't know. But when people started moving, they probably never met with one another again. So they had one way of communicating. Again they separated and then moved to some other place, then they had some other way of communicating. So we see a common ground, but when people separated and they were communicating among themselves, they came up with another few sounds which were specific only to them, and then as they moved, probably some of them were retained, some of them were lost. We don't know how many sounds may have been lost even in the languages that we have today, because sound change is one of the big process of language change. Okay, sound change is one of the big indicators. Remember, I was trying to show you the distinction between three kinds of sa: dental sa, that is dental fricative, palatal sha, and then there was a retroflex sha. And I told you that retroflex sha has some languages have lost that one, and what we have, we only have palatal sha. And even between palatal sha and dental sa, some languages have one and some languages have other, right? Which means in language A, we may not have both palatal sha and retroflex sha. In language B, we may not have palatal dental sha and retroflex sha, right? So, and this loss is recent, therefore we can even put our fingers on them. Some of the losses may not have been recorded, so we don't know what has happened to sound. However, we do know sounds have played a great role in language change, and therefore some languages in the present form, when we see them, have a particular set of sounds. Some languages have another set of sounds. Nobody says that they are going to stay that way, they are going to change too. However, what is predictable is the following, and which will probably not change, is all the languages will keep sharing sounds. There will not be a language which doesn't share sound with other one. That will probably not change. I am very well aware this doesn't completely answer that question. That question doesn't have an answer. Okay? You can think, you can read, one can speculate, one can write something else, but can never be a complete answer to a question like this. Get it? Coming back to our discussion, first and second patterns give us lot of words. The moment we start with clusters, we start seeing a reduced number of words, which simply means the clusters are heavy. Okay? Now, the evidence of a cluster being really very heavy is coming from the fourth pattern. Can you think of some words with fourth pattern where we have three sounds, three consonants forming a cluster to make a word? String. Loud.
String.
So what are the sounds here? I suggest please keep writing these words. String. And underline the sounds that are part of cluster. You will see a magic in this thing. The sounds are sa, ta, and ra. Okay? True. This is a cluster. It's string. Sa, ta, and ra. All right? More? Stray. So what are the sounds here? Sa, ta, and ra. All right. More?
Spray.
And sounds here are? Sa, pa and ra. More?
Screw.
Screw. Sounds here are? Sa, ka, ra. I can stop, but for your fun part, can you tell me more?
Sclerosis.
So the sounds are?
Sa, ka, la.
Sa, ka, and la. More?
Prawns.
Sorry?
Prawn.
Prawn. Sounds are?
Three.
We are talking about three. So you are right. In a word like prawn, we have pa and ra. Probably you thought of this example because you were looking at the written writing system where you see a W or something, right? But it has only two sounds, pa and ra, right? We are talking about three. Throw. What's the sounds are? Tha, ra, and after that you get a vowel. So that's not three. That's only two. We are talking about three. Can you be more imaginative? Just give me a word. Give me a word, sorry.
Stroke.
Stroke. All right. So the sounds are? Sa, ta, and ra. Now, while you are thinking, and I am still waiting for a few more examples, let me say the following. We are talking about some of these words from English, clearly, right? You are not coming up with words from our languages. What we are going to see as generalization applies to our languages also. It's just that you are not giving those sounds, those words. Okay? So, generalizations derived from English words are applicable to all languages. So, do you see anything common in what you have seen, what you have given so far? Anything common in the examples that you have given so far?
Starts from the front and goes back.
That's very nice, true. But look at the sounds. What's the first sound in all of them?
Sa.
Sa. Do you see, this cannot be a coincidence. That the moment you want a word with three clusters, you cannot have one beginning with any other sound. Any sound other than sa. Okay? And this is no big time discovery or anything. It's just pretty obvious. We speak these words every day. We learn these things the way I am telling you. It's just that this is the process that is called reinventing. We are not inventing anything new. It's called reinventing or making something little bit more obvious. All right? It's not that these words you didn't know. These are your examples. It's just that we didn't pay attention to this thing. This is like chicken and the egg story.
Yes.
So, a good question though. You are saying, did we have first sounds and then we made words?
Did we have words and then we figured out the way we form words?
Definitely.
Really followed a bunch of rules, or did we make the words based on a bunch of rules that we created?
No. We have words. Okay. Let me put it the following way. These things that I am trying to show you, when somebody came up with these rules, definitely they looked at huge data set and then they came up with this pattern. It must have been very exciting at the time when someone figured out that you cannot have a word without a vowel. Sounds very, very generic and a matter of general knowledge today, but must have been very exciting for them.
Why is it that we can't have words with different sounds, like instead
of starting with the sa. Is it that we can't have it, or is it difficult to pronounce and people?
That answer I can give you. But let me talk about the question that you raised before. It's a very interesting question. So these patterns were made explicit definitely on the basis of large data set, where the claim is not this fun. The claim is there is an underlying pattern of word formation. Now, these patterns are part of principles and parameters which are part of universal grammar and which are part of language acquisition device that we are born with. We trigger them with these examples, and therefore we speak the way we do. See this thing? So it's not that we have a set of sounds in one compartment and then rules in the other, and rules apply to sounds and then we get words. It's all together. Okay? And definitely the generative process is that we need to trigger those rules to get these things. That's the answer I can give you for that. Now, let's look at more, and then you will see why they all begin only with sa. Okay? What's the second sound in these clusters? Second sound is? They are either pa or ta or ka. You can come up with 100 words, but they all are going to have sounds like, second one can only be pa, ta, ka. Okay? One of the three. Now, what's common in one of the three? We are going to look at that in a moment. And the third one can only be either ra or la. Now, again, the underlying idea is this constraint is very strict. The stricter the constraint, the heavier the word. By heavy, you understand what we mean by heavy. The heavier the word for the apparatus, therefore fewer in number. All right? Now, these words with three consonants, if you compare them with the words with cluster of two consonants, are again way too few in number in any language. They could be a handful of them. Okay? And this being these things being handful, I am not concluding on the basis of you not giving more examples. Okay? We don't come up with more examples, have nothing to say, that we have established well before. Okay? They are very few in number. You can count them. I mean, if you won't be too wrong if you say English may not have, let's say, more than 100 or 150 words like them. By 150, I'm not trying to put a number on that. It could be 200, but or even for that matter, it's 500. What's the big deal about that? Which is not true. Definitely, 500 is not true. But the point is, if you can come up with 5,000 with one pattern, and then the third pattern which just makes another string little bit tighter and gets reduced to 10%. And if you look at the previous one, which were millions, and you added one more constraint on that and got reduced to, let's say, 5 lakhs or for that matter 1 lakh. That's too heavy a constraint. Just put one small constraint, it gives you, it becomes such a heavy that it has dramatic change in total number of words. That's the constraint we are looking at, right? I'm coming to this in a moment. To conclude this thing, Yeah, I'm coming to that in a moment. I'm coming to that slide in a moment again. See the last one? Four consonants as a cluster. Do you see a star in the beginning of that? For your information, this star means not possible. Four consonants as part of the cluster, not possible. And this answer could be simple for you. Answer must be simple for you. Why?
Extremely heavy.
Not possible. Will become too heavy for processing. Therefore, not possible. Okay? And this is not possible in any language. No language gives you four clusters of consonants. Now, for you, and in the interest of time, I should add, in the beginning of the word, there are few words in English where at the end of the word, a cluster of four consonants is possible. Okay? I think the word sixth has probably four clusters, or there are a couple more. Again, not a significant thing, very significant to discuss. However, the point is, even if it's possible at the end, it's possible only for few words, not more than five. Definitely, and five I am being generous. Okay, in the beginning of a word, definitely not possible in any language. Now, the point for us to take from here is, see the weight of these constraints and see the patterns involved in the formation of some of the words. These are called phonotactic rules. By no means I am giving you all the possible patterns and all the possible rules of word formation. I am just giving you a flavor of these things. Yes, sir.
Every word has to start with this, if it has a cluster of three.
If it has a cluster of three consonants, the first consonant must be sa, not s, sa.
There is a word, called fcron, F-C-R-O-N, F-C-R-O-N,
F-C-R-O-N, fron,
F-C-R-O-N, fcron.
What is, how is that pronounced?
Fcron.
So the first one is sa.
No, F, F.
No, but the way I hear you saying is scron. I'm not familiar with that word. What I am asking you is, you tell me what's the first sound?
Fa.
Fa. So the word is fron.
F C R O N.
So how do we say this word? Tell me.
Cron.
You cannot say this thing.
He is saying fa fully without eliminating the schwa sound.
Fakran, something like that? Yes. Fakran. You can't do that. Is there a word like that?
No, I'm just asking if there is a word like that.
No, there, you are artificially creating one where the problem is, right, like someone said, in the sound fa, the schwa is not deleted, the sound a is not deleted. Therefore, you are having difficulty saying this, I am having difficulty saying that. And imagine, we drop that. We won't be able to say that. I invite you to say that word. So, you are right. On the paper, we can do anything. But that's not going to be word. And definitely, that word is not going to be available in the inventory of words to be assigned meaning. See this, see the point. See, the formation of words is one part. And how such words, if they are legitimate words based on these patterns, get meaning is a completely different process. And I think I have told you that the relationship between a word and its meaning is arbitrarily matched, is arbitrarily put together. Why this thing is called a pointer has got no rational behind it. We could have called it aeroplane. It would still mean the same thing. I mean, if in the beginning If everybody called it aeroplane, we will call it an aeroplane. Would not make any difference. It sounds ridiculous today, because the moment we say aeroplane, we have something else in our mind, because we know the word aeroplane is assigned for something else. Get this thing? So that's a different process. Coming to this, you can do it on paper, but you won't be able to say that. In order to be able to say a word, this is what has been derived. This is not a prescriptive rule that you must say sa. This is, if you happen to say three clusters in a word, the first one must be sa. Our first one appears to be only sa. Let's put it that way. That's the point. Okay? So, now, yeah.
What about words like accreditation, where it's like A, K, R put together?
So, tell me now, what's the word in accreditation?
So,
that's the vowel. Accreditation.
In that case, when you say CC, CBC, that means,
No.
Does it mean only to five-letter words or any kind of?
Again, it takes long time to get out of this thing. When we say five-letter words, we are not talking about letters. We are talking about sounds.
Does this arrangement generally mean only for words with five sounds or words that start with these five sounds?
No. First of all, we are talking about this word, this cluster of three in the beginning of a word.
Yes, sir.
That's the thing that I am trying to show you. But I am saying something more than that also. What I am saying is, when we look at a word, we are talking about looking at sounds involved in the word, not the letters involved in the word.
Do these rules apply only to five sound words, or do they?
No. It could be any number of sounds in a word.
So, but this type of patterns, that means starting of a word, you can generalize it to starting of a word, they can meet a single word also. For example, if you say string, you can say stringing. The same rules apply to stringing.
Sure, definitely true.
I heard your
question as a different one, and that is important to clarify. When you say a word like accreditation, right, what are the sounds involved in that? The first sound is a vowel, so that's out. Second one is ka and ra. So that's a cluster of only two sounds, right? The following sound becomes a vowel.
Sir, what about words like
kripa? So what's the, tell me? Before you say pa, there is an intervention of a vowel, right? Before you say the third one, ka, ra and pa, before the pa, there is a vowel. See that? True. So, you must get three of them. Okay? If you have a break, then you can have any, because we are not talking about words with two clusters, words with cluster of two sounds. If we are talking about two sounds in a cluster, then we can get any two sounds. We are talking about a cluster of three sounds. In that three, you must have first one, sa. Please think about more words. I invite you, this is not the only 50 minutes where we can talk about this. Think about more words, but just keep in mind that we are talking about sounds, not letters. Okay? So, the first one must be sa. Second one can only be either pa, ta or ka. Yes, sir.
Sir, you said that the second sound can only be sa, ka or ta.
No, you said second sound can only be pa, ta or ka.
But it could also be ta, right?
Ta.
It may not be possible in English, but it is possible in
Yeah. See, this is why we discussed both retroflex and dental. And then we have also discussed something called alveolar, the English ta. So, they are all from the same reason. Therefore, I am saying ta. So, in our language, it could be either ta, which is complete dental, or in other languages, it could be an alveolar ta. softer, right? In a word like, let's say, string. It's not a retroflex ta, ta, it's ta. Therefore, I am putting it that way. This is the reason why we discussed the differences between, remember, do people remember here the difference between ta as a dental, ta as a retroflex, and then the intermediate alveolar one, which are the sounds that we get in English. Very nice. Now, what's the common between these three sounds? Pa, ta, and ka. It's not all of them are from the front of the vocal apparatus. Ka is velum. See that? What's common between all three of them is they are all stop sounds. Stop sounds mean total closure and then release of air. Pa, ta, ka. The common in the manner of articulation in all three of them is they are all stop sounds. Okay? And the common between ra and la is these two sounds are called liquid sounds. Okay? Now, liquid doesn't mean much. Liquid is not something like physical liquid, water or oil. However, it is something of that sort in nature. Don't have much to say about them at this moment, but I can simply give you one generic example that you may find some people who interchange these two sounds. Okay? When they would want to say ra, they would end up saying la, or the other way around. Some of such things are also attributed to some kind of a speech disorder, and some of these things are very commonly known as metathesis or something like that. But the point is, whether it's a speech disorder or not is not our job to hint at. Our thing is, this even in the speech disorder, the alternation is between only these two sounds. So some people, can you think of some examples? I have found, instead of saying rail, I have found some people saying lail. Okay? And where they are supposed to say la, for example, lal, the instead of ra, la, they put ra. Okay? Now, this may not give you the answer, but this is just an application of what I am saying, which is these two sounds are liquids, therefore this interchange. Now, the third one of this cluster must only be either one of the two. Therefore, you get sounds like spring, string, screw, splash, and many other words that you gave. Most of them have been seen in the beginning of it, yes. Beginning of a word, it's difficult to get a cluster of three sounds somewhere else. However, that is not denied. Somewhere else it's quite common. Come up with some of the words. Probably there also it will be sapa.
Thanks.
Sorry?
Thanks. D-A-N-G-S. Thanks.
Again, you're talking about written things. Written letters. If you say those sounds and pay attention to them, there will be a break with the vowel.
You're saying
N-G-S doesn't. Yes. And if at all that counts, that's one consonant, which is N. Velar nasal, na, na. Okay? All right. That's all. That's what I had to say to tell you today. There are a couple of other things about words which I do want to bring to your attention, because this is the, so far we have seen some patterns. Now we are going to see some additional rules applicable for formation of words, and then we go to sentence right away from there, to see more rules of why and how sentences are not simply cluster of words. Okay? They will make more sense when we look at those things through the intermediate rules that are applicable in formation of words and then a better understanding of sounds is definitely going to help us what we see little later. All right?
We stop here.